last words that Dave gave us in our tutorial the other night was, sweethearts, 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 sweethearts. And this was rehearsing this morning because I didn't have some paper. And thankfully, Shane set this up beautifully. Shane started it, Joanna jumped in with, you're more than an outdoor instructor. So this is going to try and wrap everything that all of my classmates have put out there, that we are more than an outdoor instructor. We're actually a socio-ecological outdoor educator. And everybody go, that's a mouthful. Tomas brought out some really big names. Yuri Fetterbrenner. He came up with the theory that different parts link in an ecosystem. Hollins said it's the integration of all of the parts. So, a couple of other things that have been coming on, making my notes. Mark said, things that we've presented already, there's nothing new. And that's correct. You know, there's different models that may not have been used here, but it's how we look at them. But I'm going to try and marry it all together. Socio-ecological model has come from the healthcare system, where they've used it to treat things like obesity, violence, and in Australia it's been adapted as a framework for teaching physical education. At its most basic, the individual is at the center of it. Their social environment, their physical environment, and then the policy environment. It's been looked at by a number of outdoor educationalist thinkers, Pryor, Labara, Higgins, and Watchout. And Higgins or Watchout and Co. in 2014 have adapted it as a model for outdoor environmental education. This was born from the realization that we can't just be in a beautiful place, that we need to know more about that. And Shane quoted them earlier when he said, what happened here 50 years ago? What happened here 100 years ago? What happened here 1,000 years ago? So we need to expand on that. That they've identified four concepts to adapt the socio-ecological model. That's a mouthful. Bear with me. For outdoor education. They're looking at the lived experience, agency and participation, place, and experimental pedagogies. I find that really hard to say, so I'm going to go back to the individual, the social environment, the physical environment, the policy environment, and try and get it to what we know as outdoor educators or socio-ecological educators in Ireland. So I've taken the theme of emigration and migration, which is a common theme that runs through our history. So adapting it for the individual, what is their experience of emigration and migration? Because when we look at the New Ireland, there are people that have come here and have left here. So it has impacted on most families in some way. The social environment, how has it impacted on friends, the families, the communities? The west of Ireland is a fantastic physical environment to talk about that. So when we see the place, nature, and the built environment, the weather, the land, famine, and the changes that have impacted on that. Then policy, land uses, traditions, barriers, and conflict, that there's resonance throughout our society for that. Both people that have been here all the time and the new arrivals, the new Irish. The implications from my own personal practice, I view this very much as a framework, as a way of identifying what is best for the individual, their social group, the physical environment that we have. So for a lot of it, we're thinking about, over the hill and far away, but in their localities, trying to get it like place-based as much as we can, and policies that would allow us, people have been commenting on, it's too wet to go outdoors, let's go outdoors, like educating people for it, getting them up and moving. But it's accessible. It's no use, I think, introducing people to rock climbing when there's no rock climbing around where they are. A greater challenge, I think, is, and Sinead touched on it earlier, is getting people to buy into it. Getting a belief that it is worth something, it is worth doing. So planning for the individual, planning for their group, planning for their locality, and all of that by the policies of either their training agencies, themselves, or ourselves will allow. It's definitely going to be slower. So there is implication for public provision outdoor centres that it isn't just going to be come in at 9 o'clock in the morning, adventure education lunch, 2 o'clock adventure education, that there might have to be more thought put into it and slowing things down. I just got like, I'm way ahead on time, so I'm going to open myself up to questions. Now, this room is, this side of the room has been very good so far, so we're going to concentrate on this one.
Yes, so does anybody have a question?
Remember, the more questions you ask, the longer we're going to be here.
Really sorry for asking a question.
Work away.
I worked in Germany for a while for Outward Bound, and each two groups were accompanied by a social pedagogian or a social pedagogue.
Yeah, exactly.
So there was a division of labor between the instructor who looked after the safety and taught technical skills, and the social learning, there wasn't any ecological learning, but do you think there's a case for separating the two parts? Would you get a better service if you had a social educator and an instructor working side by side?
Go back to the question that you asked me earlier, like 3-year-olds to corporate trainers, like if it was one person that could do all of them and they had all the skills and they could do it very, very well, you know, why not? But if it takes teamwork, because again, that's, you know, the individual center plus the social environment. So we all work as a team. Some of us help us. More strengths and skills in certain areas. So I would look at what is best for the individual. Who or what do we need to make that experience, whatever we're aiming for, the most beneficial that it can be. Fair enough, or am I dodging the question?
I felt, because I've gone from Outward Bound Abu Dhabi, where you did everything yourself, to Outward Bound Germany, where there was a distinction between that. I'm just interested in your response to it, because the social pedagogues were master's level in their subject, you know, and obviously the outdoor activity instructors had reached the right qualifications level for doing what they were doing. And it actually worked very well, although I felt a bit cheated because I had been doing both jobs before I went out there. I just wonder how you would reflect on that.
Adaption, I think, between like different cultures, which is what we've been like hitting on today, of bringing international practices to a location. So you mentioned Outward Bound Abu Dhabi, moving to Germany, where it's would be a different mentality. Maybe they have more supports because historically they invest in people, that they plan, there's much more central planning and things aren't cut back, because that's been one of the things that people have been mentioning, funding, Chris Lyons, Tom, talking about austerity and how that impacts on it. This is a socio-ecological method model theory. It's a planning framework that we can use if we take the time and that we become student-centered and everything that ties into that, like, it'd be great to have the best kayakers working. But if it's not a kayaking program, it's something that's based from a schoolyard working out, we don't need that. We just need to empower the teachers and the group and making it realistic and student-centered, because the individual is at the middle of it. But just taking, you know, just slowing down. Answer or dodge? Oh. Sharon Kurt.
Thank you, Peter, for doing this poster. I think it's great. It's added to the diversity of posters that we've had over the day. And I think particularly, if we're to go back to what Florian spoke about this morning, where he was talking about inclusion, which is a social construct, and he was talking about education for sustainable development, which is an environmental component, then you have two views maybe on an outdoor educator, which link to what you're talking about there. I was very interested when Kirsty was talking about the planning documentation from Norway, and she was saying that the new document which came out had a 50-year plan for pedagogy. When did you ever hear about anything in Ireland having a 50-year plan, other than a mortgage? So I think if we were to look towards planning for the future for outdoor education in Ireland, and planning for professional practice, that maybe we, our vision might take us beyond the short term or the short sighted, and beyond our own involvement in it, and look at societal involvement in it, and look at the society of outdoor educators that will be there in the future, that maybe linking an outdoor educator who is responsive to the sociological needs of the individuals, who's understanding of it and connected to it, and also understanding the physical environment and the social environment from which they come, and also has a mind towards the sustainability of our planet in the long term. If they were all key issues for the outdoor educator in 50 years' time, maybe that would be a goal for us, a long-term goal. Thank you.
Great question.